In December, Spielberg turned 70. In his eighth decade on Earth, he is still making movies as fast as we can see them. What keeps him going? The answer, or rather the mystery, begins with the outsized fears of a little boy who began biting his nails while still in knee pants. A little boy who was spooked by everything, by the static on the radio, by Disney films, by the tree outside his New Jersey window that turned sinister in a storm, its branches weaving and waving like some otherworldly monster. What makes him unusual is not just the size of his fears, but his manner of holding on to them. Rather than bury these shaming moments of childhood vulnerability, he nourished their memory, translated them into bold cinematic images, and projected them onto a terrified audience, as he had once relieved his own anxiety by terrorizing his younger sisters. So powerful was the urge, and so successful an exorcism, that as a director, he would aim for nothing less than whole theaters full of spectators biting their nails, or blissed out with awe at close encounters with the paranormal. In the weeks leading up to the 2014 Academy Awards, there was a statistic that was trotted out on some of the shows of who Oscar winners thank most. The top two names were Steven Spielberg and God, and Steven Spielberg had 42 to God's 19. And I talk a little bit about what this means, how has he managed to have that much influence. And I talk about the staggering output and the fact that he's worked in different media and he's mentored people and given more pleasure than almost any other filmmaker. And if he hasn't touched every heart and every mind with every picture, it's a guarantee that he has touched even the harshest critic with one or two or three. And it's also the amazing the way he's combined profits with the foundation with eleemosynary activities. And having directed two of the top 10 grossing films of all time, E.T. the Extraterrestrial and Jaws. But when Yale came to me with the idea, I did not originate this idea, they came to me with the idea, you know, they had this Jewish Live series, and so Spielberg was, they wanted Spielberg to be the subject of one. I hesitated for obvious and not so obvious reasons. I didn't worry about not being Jewish, let other people do that. I strongly believe there should be no bars of race, ethnicity, or gender to writing, and I think it's particularly important in the case of Spielberg, for one of his greatest traits has always been a kind of natural ecumenism, a generosity of spirit. He grew up in mostly Gentile suburbs in New Jersey and Arizona, and belatedly found his path to Judaism. He was with, his father had gotten, his family had migrated, his grandparents had migrated to Cincinnati, that's where he was born. There was a large Jewish community, a large enclave. And then the parents, the father was a kind of engineering genius, and he got a job. This was at the time of assimilation, post-war assimilation anyway. And the father got a job at GE in New Jersey working in the new field of computer technology. So they moved to New Jersey and lived in Gentile neighborhoods, largely Catholic neighborhoods. And he still had this Orthodox grandfather who would come in. He said they would have to hide the lobsters under the bed when the grandfather came. But he was with all these Christians, and at Christmas time, they would have the lights and the creches and this, and they would accuse him of killing Jesus. It was terrible to him. He was a kind of antisocial kid, sort of mischievous antisocial kid anyway, and he felt so out of it. All he wanted to do was not be a Jew during this period. It wasn't until much later, it was when he finally had a son and also making Schindler's List that brought him into the faith. The thing that really, you know, it's funny how the book has come out now, and I've read some reviews, and you sort of discover things after you've written a book, or discover a way of seeing something, and it suddenly occurred. I'll go into this. In fact, I'll just talk some of it because I sort of like doing that. And I decided that the way to tell it, he said several times, my whole life story is in my films. So this appealed to me as a film critic, because I would have preferred to tell the story through the films anyway. So that's what I did. I just go film by film, and it really is true. His life is all there. But I realized it's also because he became a filmmaker before he became a person. So that's why he never, when he was a teenager, when other guys were going out on dates, he was saving all his money. He started when he was about 14 years old, taking home movies. And, you know, most people take the obvious home movies, people getting in a car and going on vacation. Well, when his parents got into, he didn't like the way they got into the car, so he would make them start over and do it again. And then he would cut it and edit it. So already he was sort of playing with narrative strategies. So his home movies weren't like anybody else's. And he was absolutely transfixed by movies. He would make movies of his train, little Lionel trains having a wreck. And the real epiphany for him, I guess, came, he joined the Boy Scouts. This was the first group because he'd had, I don't know if it was just before this or right after, but he had had a bar mitzvah, and he was so unhappy with that and what it meant. He was throwing oranges at people over a balcony or something. So the Boy Scouts was the first time he felt he belonged somewhere, and the way it happened was they were going for their badges, and all the others were doing all these outdoor sort of athletic things, and he wasn't a jock at all. But his father said, why don't you go for the photography badge and make a movie? So that's what he did. He was so incredibly successful. I mean, he was already good at telling stories at the campfires. They would sit around and he would tell stories, and the kids would be galvanized, and they loved the movie. And he sort of came into his own at that moment. And he knew that's what he wanted, that sound of applause and as many people as possible. So when other guys were going out on dates, he was saving his money to buy films. So, and also, he had a very vexed relationship with his father. So he didn't sort of go through the usual sort of Oedipal thing of identifying with the father and leaving the mother and going to adult women. I mean, he basically didn't become an adult. And the father actually was, when you read about what the father did, it was a tremendous amount. He helped him find location. Well, the mother did that. The mother was a real free spirit. She was an artist in her own right. She was a pianist who'd given up a concert career. And but she loved his filmmaking. She would write notes so he could play hooky from school, and they would go scout locations. But now they were living in Arizona. I mean, after New Jersey, they moved to Arizona, to an even more conservative sort of Gentile area, where he felt even more out of it. And he also was getting a little embarrassed by his mother's. At first it was so wonderful, she was like his playmate, and then suddenly he thought, well, you know, she was a free spirit, but other sort of these more conservative matrons sort of looked at her sort of skeptically, and he just wished he had a normal mother that would go to the PTA. But he was trying to find his place. But to go back to when Yale came to me with this project, I thought, well, it wasn't the Jewish thing I was worried so much about, but I just wasn't that much of a fan of Spielberg. I'd say that we both had our blind spots. The problem was Spielberg's blind spots were my C spots, and vice versa. He readily acknowledged that he had no feeling for European films. He always wanted his films to arrive someplace. But brooding ambiguities, things left unsaid, and the erotic transactions of men and women are the very things that drew me to movies in the first place. His great subjects, children, adolescents, and genres, science fiction, fantasy, horror, action, adventure, were stay-away zones for me. I worried about my biases, my inherent lack of sympathy as a woman, as a person, for the genres in which he had enjoyed his greatest successes. Some of us were very hard. In fact, we were very hard on his early films. This was like 73, I think, when Jaws came out, and 77 or something was Close Encounters. And this was a time that is now considered one of the golden ages of cinema, the late 60s and early 70s, when Bonnie and Clyde and The Graduate came out in 67, and then Coppola and Scorsese and Brian De Palma and all these kind of new talents were making European-style movies in America, but with Hollywood money. I mean, it was this brief period of auteur films in America, and then along came Jaws, and then came Close Encounters and Star Wars, and everything changed. I mean, probably something like that would have come along anyway, because I don't think Hollywood was ever really comfortable with these independent, these kind of anarchic filmmakers. But this is what did come along, and it seemed like all of a sudden everything was about, I mean, you never had read box office receipts. Now the Times and other papers would publish the Monday morning record of what movies had made at the box office. It was all about money. Suddenly there were malls and multiplexes everywhere, and it was about the wide opening. And it was just a whole, and it was also a cinema that was really directed at young people, especially young males, who would go over and over and over again to the same film. And it was also global because There was a minimum of dialogue. Focus was on action. But the funny thing is that we were hard as early films, and I was. That's one of the reasons I wanted to anticipate this in this preface, so that people looked it up, they would understand. Because I was writing for The Voice at that time, and other people everywhere were concerned. And it was a real sense of foreboding, because we were believers in cinephilia. It was a time of excitement about European films and so forth. And I think that was... the funny thing, though, was that Jaws came out, and Jaws was... considered, I mean, I look back at the reviews, some people loved it, of course it was, as you know, a huge hit, but most critics thought of it as just a purely mechanical thriller. But the funny thing, this is how time changes everything, as movies became more and more mechanical, and more of the superhero and franchise movies, and sort of repetitions of themselves, Jaws came to look like a sort of humanist masterpiece. And it's kind of like when we all were so upset when Barnes & Noble came, and all the independent bookstores, praise to them, were being vanquished by Barnes & Noble. Now we're grateful to have a Barnes & Noble, so things changed a lot, and Spielberg's films changed, our perception of them also changed with them. Then I had to ask, I felt I should make a gesture and ask him if he would talk to me, which I did, and fortunately he wouldn't. He has a policy of not speaking to biographers, and this was true. Joseph McBride wrote the kind of full-dress biography of Spielberg. Came out about 15 years ago, and that was updated. Excellent book, which I plundered for mine, because Spielberg wouldn't talk to him either. But McBride got to everybody else. He got to the father, the school teachers, the schoolmates. The only person he couldn't get to was the mother, because Spielberg told her she couldn't talk to him. I think he was afraid. She was sort of a blabbermouth. He was afraid of what she would say. So, but he got to everybody else. And I thought also there might be a bit of a grudge, because when I was researching it, I found this clip on YouTube where Spielberg is teaching a master class at the AFI, the American Film Institute. This is like 1978, after Jaws and Close Encounters. And they're all sort of looking at this kid in a baseball cap who's suddenly this multimillionaire, and they're just all kind of skeptical, and what are you going to do now? What is this all about? And he said, well, you just got to have confidence. You have to do what you want to do and have confidence, and you can't worry if critics like Andrew Saris and Molly Haskell don't like your movies. So I thought, well, maybe there's a little bit of a grudge, but so he turned me down as a matter of policy, and I felt kind of rejected, but I also was very, very grateful, really, because I knew that if I had met him, I would be seduced. I mean, I don't mean in any sort of technical sense, but just simply meeting him and being conscripted into his point of view, and that I was a nice girl and I wouldn't want to say bad things about it. And it's not the book is not negative, it's just I wanted to be free to be critical of some things, of his inability to have an adult, to deal with adults, period, of them, say adult men and women. All the films, he knows that he's not good at it, so he didn't try very often, always, with Richard Dreyfuss and Holly Hunter is a failure, because it tries to deal with grown-up love. And so I had to point that out, but he's not alone among American directors at fleeing. This is also a period of the emerging women's movement, and Scorsese and Coppola, they weren't dealing very much with grown-up love either, but they were more... Their films did have a kind of adult ambiguity and darkness that Spielberg's didn't. But then as I came to look at them, I think, first of all, that for me, they just became more and more interesting. I know people love the early ones, and I can understand that, but I thought they became more interesting as he grew older and more complicated. And he's used, interestingly, for somebody who's thought of as sentimental, and there are great swaths of sentimentality in the films, he's used two of the darkest writers of the 20th century, I think, J.G. Ballard and Philip K. Dick. And there's darkness throughout the films, because I think the great theme in Spielberg is the family. And it's what's really unique with him, even when he's doing science fiction or adventure, or especially with science fiction, which is usually seen as escapist. I mean, it's escape from the family, it's escape from adult reality, which is its appeal for adolescent males and some females too. I don't want to exclude women in this, but he brings the family into the science fiction. It was his obsession because his parents were fighting all the time. They finally did divorce, and he was very, very bitter about that. He blamed his father, who it turns out was not the one responsible. Many, many years later, it turned out it was his mother who was having an affair with the father's best friend and divorced the father and married this man. So there was a lot of kind of angst and bitterness to go around. But I think what you see in him all the way through, and I go all the way through to Bridge of Spies, is somebody wanting to go home. I think one of my favorite films is Catch Me If You Can, the thing with Leonardo DiCaprio as the forger and imposter. And the last scene is he's so childlike going home and his mother sitting there with a new family. And in Bridge of Spies, Tom Hanks has this cold, he just wants to go home, and he finally gets home. So I think that yearning, so it's not that Spielberg lacked for deep feelings, because the yearning and the yearning for home, and also the sense that it's a mirage. I mean, AI, I think, is one of the great films. It's uneven in certain ways. The one he did from a Kubrick script, sort of. It's also a child's reunion with a mother in fantasy, really. And it's very bleak in its way. So I'll kind of maybe leave it at that and just see if you have any. Are you Spielberg fans here, or just dropping by for curiosity, or what's your?
I was interested in your take on
it. Yeah, well, that's pretty much what it is. And as I say, I came to admire more things than I had ever before, and also to appreciate even more the ones like Empire of the Sun. I saw that at the Metrograph recently, and it's really a harsh film because it's about a child's view of war. And Christian Bale gives this magnificent performance. That's the one from the J.G. Ballard script. And it's really his story of being in Shanghai when the Japanese attack, and he being lost from his parents, thrust out of his home in a detention camp, and having to fend for himself. And you realize how thin the layer, he's come from this very cobbled, cushioned world of the British expatriates, and suddenly there he is on his own with these raffish people, John Malkovich. And you realize how thin this layer of civilization is, and also how he loves the war. I mean, the child doesn't see, he responds to the Japanese pilots. He thinks of them as brave and stoic. He wants to be one. And so it's a very dark, in a way, view of war, and yet it's also sort of exultant because it shares the child's point of view. And I think a very complex film. I think it's a great film. I think Munich, others, I don't know if any you will like particularly or would recommend, but so I do think it's interesting. Jeffrey O'Brien does a long piece in the New York Review of Books on my book is sort of the hook of his take. And I actually quote him in the book, in his piece on Minority Report. I think the people who, they're extremes. Like there's a website that I discovered it's called AV Club, and I'm not sure, it sounds to me like young film buff Spielberg nuts who you can't say anything against Spielberg. So I think they also feel impugned, maybe they feel their masculinity impugned or something, so they trash it. And then at the other extreme, one I haven't read, is The New Statesman, which says Spielberg ruined cinema. So those are the two extremes. And then in between, I think people are really trying to sort of come to terms with him because we've taken him for granted as an entertainer, and as we did with Hitchcock. Is it the same situation? Is he going to be honored in that way? And the point is that Jeffrey O'Brien takes a sort of highbrow view and does indeed, I think, takes him even more seriously than I do, because I still have reservations. But I think this is one of the things that was troubling me in writing the book, was the dust hasn't settled on his career. It's too early to say, but that too sort of seemed fun to me. It just seemed like it would be, I think the word people use is counterintuitive, for me to write this, but I think it also, I think, makes for an interesting sort of fresh take on something that who needs another adulatory Spielberg biography, and there's already one complete one that I think is excellent. So, do you have any thoughts on any Spielberg films that you?
Thank you.
Okay, you're welcome.
Which film do you feel? Did you say Schindler's List was the one where you thought he matured?
Yeah, well, I think even more than the film, he didn't want to do it. He'd been brooding about it for some time. His producer had showed him the book, and he read it, and he thought it was great. He wanted somebody to do it. He talked to Martin Scorsese and other people. They were maybe going to do it. And then finally, something got to him. He read Billy Wilder wanted to do one, and Kubrick also. They both had wanted to do films on the Holocaust, and Wilder urged him to do it. And I think he was beginning more and more to feel a kind of sense of responsibility. I mean, that's always been another quality that I think is admirable, as you obvious from the Shoah Foundation and the other nonprofit organizations that he's funded, that he wanted to do something for. And he had his first child, Max. And that really brought him back into the church, and our other synagogue, sorry. I didn't say that in the book. Max was a son with Amy Irving, but then gradually they were already very soon splitting up, and he was going out with Kate Capshaw, who is an interesting character. She was in the Indiana Jones and the Temple of Doom in a terrible role. I mean, that's when you really see, she starts off great, and she's got this fabulous, in this sort of bubbly, Busby Berkeley nightclub number, and then she just becomes this shrieking woman. And I use that, Spielberg films are full of shrieking women. I mean, lots of male adventure films are full of shrieking women waiting to get rescued, but somehow the women in Spielberg films shriek louder and longer. So she became a sort of parody in that film, but she met him at that time. She knew that she wanted to marry, she just, something in her fell for him, and his films had spoken to her, and he was still tied up with Amy Irving, but eventually they did get together, and she converted to Judaism, and she really, I don't think she did it as just to snare him. She was very upfront about how she wanted to marry him, but that was something quite sincere. And then he was having children with her, and her children, and then adopted children. So ultimately, it was this huge brood. And I think one of the inspiring things for his later films is to teach children. I think sometimes it goes too far into sort of pedagogy, you know, underlining things, sort of educational. But for the most part, I mean, he manages to tell stories really well, and also kind of make educational points. I think with movies like Lincoln, and, you know. So, what was the question?
You said that, is that the point where
you... Yes, yeah. Well, I think it all sort of coalesced. I think he had just lived so much from movies until a really ripe age. And he said that I think that was why he made Always, because breaking up with Amy Irving, he was in his, well into his 30s. It was like an adolescent, the first love and the breakup. So everything, it was very arrested development. In fact, remember Big, the movie with Tom Hanks? That was, his sister wrote that script, and it was really based on him, this little guy that never grows up, who's playing with toys all the time. And most of the women he went out with, they didn't like to watch movies around the clock, so out they went. But ultimately, he achieved a kind of balance. And I think it's very unusual, because most artists, we look at somebody like Woody Allen, they just need to keep replenishing the... I guess this is when an artist's work is based on women, they need to keep replenishing the supply, whereas his movies were more on family in the first place. So he's been true to that ideal, I think. And I think so much wanted, and that yearning in all those films for home is one that he's tried to satisfy himself with his children. Yeah. So it's really nice.
Can you comment at all on his relationship with George Lucas?
Well, yeah, it's interesting. He saw THX 1138 when it was a student film. It all started in the early 70s. They were all these would-be filmmakers, and actually Coppola had already made a film, and Scorsese was about to make one, and Schrader, and all these guys, they hung out at this beach. And then they would go to the different studios. Spielberg was already working. He never went to film school. He tried to get into film school, but his grades weren't good enough. So somehow he got this job, this lowly job at Universal, and he was the one that was wearing had the briefcase and a tie when all the rest of them were smoking pot and hanging out at the beach. But they all met, and of course had so much in common. And he went to Universal to see the student film that George had made, THX 1138, which was eventually expanded into a feature film, and he was just knocked out. And he felt very competitive. He said, this guy's done something, I haven't done anything like that. But he also was excited. He was stimulated. I think that thing you see with great like Federer and Nadal, how they sort of push each other. If anyone's a tennis fan, they push each other to greater feats and heights. So they became friends. I think when Star Wars, the story is that he and a bunch of people were at the studio looking at it, and everybody thought, oh, this is going nowhere. And he said, you're wrong. This movie is going to make millions. And he was quite jealous at that time because, what was his film? Was it E.T. or Close Encounters was coming out at the same time? Close Encounters. And yeah, and he knew that, and it did, in fact, sweep all the attention away from Close Encounters. So, but he always was gracious, publicly gracious, and they were good friends. And after this, they went off together on vacation and came up with the Indiana Jones idea, and they did that together. So I think they've been, I mean, it's interesting how competitive the men are in the film industry, but also how collegial, I think. They really are pulling for each other. And they can all kind of, they can get angry at the studios together, just like writers get mad at something, so they're,
I mean. I know that Lucas is known as a taskmaster. Was Spielberg also a great taskmaster? Did he really drive?
He does, and you don't hear much about it. And I didn't, Brian's biography doesn't have too much about it, but he can be very tough on the set. He's very much a perfectionist. And for instance, there was a time when Kubrick thought, well, maybe they could make AI together, and Spielberg really didn't want any part of that because he knew that he'd be overshadowed by, he just doesn't want anybody on the set with him. And I think he's tough on people, he drives a very hard bargain financially. Another question that arises often, it only happens, when a film is successful, I mean, there are always film screenwriters working that don't get credit. You know, somebody works on it. Generally, nobody knows, I mean, exact proportion of contribution of one writer or another, and somebody, they argue it out at the Authors Guild and all that. But Spielberg didn't like to write. I mean, he can tell a story, but he hated to write, so he would just imbibe other people's ideas and read other people's scripts, and then they would be annoyed. But it seemed to me, and I cite examples of this in the book, it seemed to me that he put his stamp on everything. He's just so much of an individual. You just know, I mean, there'd be a John Sayle script or a Paul Schrader wrote the original script for Close Encounters, but they have their sensibilities are so far apart. And Schrader's, they both have a kind of religious bent, but a very different kind of religious bent. And I think Schrader's hero was going to be a much darker figure. And he complained that that Spielberg would take him, the character in Close Encounters, and he would go to another planet and open a McDonald's. And Spielberg said, "Well, that's what I want—an ordinary man who would go to McDonald's and go to another planet, Mars, and open a McDonald's." But the character he came up with is definitely not that kind of person. That played by Richard Dreyfuss, he really is more of an artist. But yeah, I think he's, I mean, he would have to be, because the control, I mean, somebody, I was on a radio show and they were talking about Close Encounters, and this guy was saying, well, he was a European style auteur with Close Encounters, because look, there was this guy going off, this dark thing, and the guy going off and leaving his family, and he had Francois Truffaut in it. But Truffaut was horrified when he saw Hollywood filmmaking close up. You know, he just couldn't believe it. They would send the car, and they would do this and that, and it took endless hours and spent so much money. I mean, no European film would ever be made anything like that, and it was science fiction, which didn't really appeal to him that much. But the control to make that movie, and there, and in so many others, in Empire of the Sun, you have these incredible crowds. I think one of the great things he does is these crowd scenes where masses of people funneling through the streets, and then you can pick out a little boy, and you can pick, I mean, it's just incredible. But I think it's something that, in fact, one of the things I was kind of concerned about, right, I wanted to write a book that would be appealing to not just film buffs, that would be a sort of entertaining story. I mean, it would have to be somebody interested in film to some extent, but not a film buff. On the other hand, I think the film writers now are so erudite, and they're so, I mean, they're this band of, they're online and everywhere, and they know everything about, except the past, they know everything about the present, and they know every Spielberg camera movement, and strategy and all the influences. I mean, I can see a lot of the influences, but they, so I had to be impeccable about the correctness of all that stuff while at the same time trying to appeal to a different, you know, a little bit wider audience. But he's completely soaked. Somebody was telling me the other day they were with him watching a Rel Walsh movie. Now, that's already a little bit obscure to most people, and he knew every craftsman on the set and what they had done. I mean, he must have watched that movie 50 times. So that's his education. He really, but he knew what he wanted. So it wasn't film school, but it was his own self-taught movie mastery education.
You said he affected a lot of people. Did you say that there is a follower to Spielberg, a director or a professor?
I think everybody is. In fact, I figured the ideal audience for that book would be 19-year-old male wannabe filmmakers who are saving all their money to buy a camera. And they'll only get the book if their parents give it to them. So, I think they all want to be him now, which is not a great thing because they see not just the mastery, and also he's very, he loves film itself as opposed to video. I mean, he uses video and he loves that too, but he knows film. And so I think he's not necessarily the greatest role model, but I mean, he just is. That's what every kid is going to want to be, I think. And you hope that they learn something about people too along the way, which I think Spielberg has.